Welcome to VRD Nation Gurukul, the channel dedicated for Indian traders and investors. Before we get started, if you are here for the first time, don't forget to subscribe. We are building this channel as the most useful resource for Indian traders. So don't miss out on all that learning. Alright, let's jump into our story. What is the one thing that is common between Harshad Mehta, Ketan Parekh, Nirav Modi and Vijay Mallya? They all found loopholes in the Indian banking system and exploited that to create insane amount of wealth. Today, we will tell you the story of the man who started it all, Harshad Mehta. Adjusted for inflation today, Harshad Mehta laundered over 24,000 crore rupees in the stock market over a period of 3 years. His story is nothing short of a Bollywood movie and there is so much to learn from it. So, let's start from the beginning. Harshad Mehta was born in 1954 into a very poor family. He completed his schooling from Raipur. But he was a very average kind of a student who didn't show much promise. He was even suspended from the school once for indiscipline and misconduct. After completing his schooling, he came to Mumbai where he did his BCom from Lala Lajpat Rai College. After graduation, he struggled a while taking low-level jobs, selling garments and appliances, etc. At that time, he had no idea what he was going to do in life, but he just kept exploring. His luck turned around when he joined New India Assurance Company as a salesperson, from where he first got interested into the stock market. He realized that this was the game he was born to play. So, he quit his job and joined a stock market brokerage firm in 1981. He quickly learned the ins and outs of the stock market, made connections with influential brokers, and within 3 years, he himself became a broker with Bombay Stock Exchange. By 1990, he had risen to prominence in the Indian stock market. He also established his own firm called Grow More Research and Asset Management. But Mehta was not satisfied with his success. He had bigger ambitions. So, in this lust for money, he started exploiting various loopholes in our banking system. At that time, Reserve Bank had mandated all the banks to keep a certain minimum level of funds into government bonds. By the end of each week, every bank needed to have a certain amount of government bonds, else RBI would penalize them. Now, there were some strong banks and there were some weak banks. The strong banks had no trouble keeping the minimum balance of government bonds, whereas the weak banks always struggled to do so. Think of it like a homework given by a teacher. The good students always finished their homework on time, whereas the weak students had to pay something to copy the homework of the strong students. So similarly, the weak banks always had to borrow the government bonds from the strong banks, and in return, they paid some interest. But these bank transactions were not done directly between the strong and weak banks. They were done through brokers, and one of them was Harshad Mehta. So Harshad Mehta would approach the weak banks and tell them that he would give them the government bonds they needed. And for getting them those bonds, the weak banks would write him a check on his personal name. Now, Mehta would ask them for some time to make the necessary arrangement. Since Mehta was so influential, these banks didn't mind waiting for a few extra days. Next, Mehta would approach the strong banks, who had those extra government bonds, and promised them to give that extra interest in return. Here also, Mehta would ask for some extra time. Since Mehta was very influential and reputed, neither of the banks had any problems giving extra time to Mehta. At the end of the promised time, he was keeping his promise to both the banks. The weak banks got the government bonds they needed, and the strong banks were very happy with the money they made from the interest. So everybody was happy. So how was Mehta making money? Remember that Mehta would ask for the extra time from both the lending and the borrowing banks? Well, during that time, he had all this massive cash in his own personal account and he was funneling that money into the stock market. He would pick select shares of the companies and just kept buying those shares aggressively. Because of this massive liquidity injection, the share prices of these stocks would go up, and because of that, other investors would also start buying the stock in anticipation of more movement. This would raise the stock prices even higher. But wait a second, if the money was being pumped into the share market, how was Mehta returning the money back to the strong banks who lent those bonds? Here is where his genius comes in. He was not just dealing with these two banks, he was dealing with a whole lot of them, and he became very good at rotating the money from lenders to borrowers, and whenever the stocks he pumped ran up a lot, he would liquidate his positions from the stock market and take care of any deficits. So all in all, Mehta was rotating the money between the banks and the stock market, and he was getting very good at that. All this was working out very well, but Mehta got more greedy. He wanted more. So he conspired with the officials of two banks, Bank of Karad and Metropolitan Cooperative Bank, to issue fake bank receipts that were not backed by any government bonds. So they were nothing but pieces of paper. Once these fake bank receipts were issued, they were passed on to the banks, and banks in turn would give money to Mehta, obviously assuming that they were lending against government securities, when that was not the case. This money was used to drive the prices of the stock in the stock market, and when the time came to return the money, shares would be sold for a profit and the bank receipt was retired. The game went on as long as the stock prices kept going up, and no one had a clue about Mehta's modus operandi. This extensive liquidity gave an adrenaline shot to the stock market in general, and the market began to make major moves. In fact, BSE quadrupled its index in a span of just 1 year, and because of that, Mehta's own portfolio of stock holdings gained in the value close to 10 times to an estimated 2,000 crore rupees. One of the stocks he pumped was ACC. He moved it from 200 rupees to 9,000 rupees. Just goes to show how crazy valuations can get when liquidity is behind a stock. Here are some other stocks that he later pumped. All this money made Mehta a hero in the stock market. People started calling him the Amitabh Bachchan of the stock market. He lived a very luxurious lifestyle and was never shy to show off his wealth. He bought a 15,000 foot property in Mumbai, which had a mini golf course and a swimming pool. He had a fleet of foreign cars, which were not even affordable to the richest of the rich people at the time. But all this show-off and blind greed got him into trouble. An investigative journalist named Sucheta Dalal got wind of Mehta's modus operandi, and she published an expose in Times of India. This was the beginning of Harshad Mehta's end. All the senior officials in the banks got alerted immediately, and the lending banks began to ask for money. Now remember that paying money back was never a problem for Harshad Mehta, because he would just sell his shares in the stock market and fulfill his obligations. But this time it was different, because as soon as the scandal broke, the market started crashing and the value of Mehta's shares dropped steeply. So he had no way of repaying those banks. It didn't take much time for CBI to step up, and they charged him with 70 counts of fraud. By this time, Mehta's game was over. He was under criminal custody in Thane prison, where he later died of heart failure. Mehta also took down a lot of senior officials with him. Vijaya Bank's chairman committed suicide by jumping from the top of a building. And top treasury officials from SBI, National Housing Bank and UCO Bank chairman, they all lost their jobs. But most tragic of all, thousands of investors lost their hard-earned money, and most of them were never able to recover their losses. Once the hero of the stock market actually turned out to be the greatest villain for those investors. Interestingly, two of the biggest Indian traders of our time, Rakesh Jhunjhunwala and Radhakishan Damani, made a lot of money by shorting the market at the time. They had the vision and understanding that the valuations of this market were clearly not sustainable, so by taking some very astute short trades, they made a lot of money. We have made separate videos for Rakesh Jhunjhunwala and Radhakishan Damani, so don't forget to check them out. Harshad Mehta's story and more recently the Nirav Modi scandal are humble reminders that our banking system and the stock market are extremely vulnerable to manipulation. It also teaches us that when the valuations of the company start to get on the crazy side, smart investors should start getting cautious instead of getting greedy. So folks, this was the story of Harshad Mehta. I hope you found this story useful. Do let us know in the comment section below, and don't forget to subscribe.